Hello all. Through this video, I'll be explaining about another type of field test which is conducted mainly during the main ground investigation, that is pile load test. Now, pile load tests are conducted to validate the results that we obtained during the design which we made after obtaining the results from the preliminary ground investigation. So to check whether the values we obtained through equations can actually be obtained in the field, we conduct such type of field test during the main ground investigation. Okay, so there are actually two types of pile load test, static as well as dynamic. In this video, the discussion will be made on static pile load test. Now, the basic objective of conducting a static pile load test is to determine the load carrying capacity of the pile. So, as I said, from the field results or from the samples obtained from preliminary ground investigation and the test conducted on the soil samples during preliminary ground investigation, we will be getting parameters which helps us in determining the load carrying capacity of piles by means of IS equations. Okay, now to validate those values, we can conduct load test on an actual pile and see whether those load carrying capacity values obtained through equations can actually be obtained at field as well or not. Okay, now this pile load test, it can be done on any type of pile, like a driven pile or a cast in situ pile, or on a working pile or a test pile, and it can be conducted either on one pile, that is a single pile, or on a group of piles. Okay, now a difference between a working pile and a test pile is that now a working pile, a working pile will become a part of the structure after conducting the test on it, whereas a test pile, it will be constructed only for the purpose of conducting pile load test. Okay, so this is the difference between a working pile and a test pile. And normally in most of the cases, the pile load tests are conducted to assess the vertical load capacity of the pile. But there are cases where we will be able to determine the uplift capacity as well as lateral load capacity of the site. So that is depending upon the conditions to which the piles will be subjected to. Okay, now both cohesionless as well as cohesive soils can be tested for pile load test. But the thing is that we are not supposed to test the, we are not supposed to start conducting the pile load test immediately after constructing or driving the piles in cohesionless as well as cohesive soils. Some time has to be given for both cohesionless as well as cohesive soils. Okay, now the reason is that both these type of soils, their properties get altered due to the driving of pile into them. Okay, if we take the case of clayey soils, mostly due to thixotropic effect, what happens is that due to pile driving, the clay particles will get remolded, and then they will lose some of their strength. Okay, then over a period of time only, after a period of time only, they will be able to regain their original strength. So we should not conduct the pile load test until they are able to regain their original strength. And therefore, in the case of clays, the pile load test will be conducted. Once driving the pile, we have to give at least, a week's time or 2 weeks' time for the clays to regain its original strength, and then only we should start conducting the pile load test on clays. Whereas in the case of sand, also the same thing happens. The sand also gets disturbed due to pile driving, and because of which it loses some of its strength. And with passage of time, by means of stress relaxation, sand will be regaining its strength as well. So, in the case of sands, after a few days only, we should be conducting pile load test, whereas in the case of clays, you should give weeks time. You should give at least a week's time for starting the pile load test, okay, after driving the piles in both these types of soils. So this figure here shows the test setup of our static pilot test or pilot test in general. So the piles will be embedded into your soil. It will be either cast in situ or driven piles, okay, in your soil, and then the load has to be applied on the pile in intervals. So the load application is either by means of a hydraulic jack. So this hydraulic jack will be either supported against a platform or against a reaction girder secured to anchor piles. Okay, so as we saw in plate load test, there was the other type of loading was by means of gravity loading, where you could use dead weights to give load on the pile. Here also, instead of this reaction loading using hydraulic jack, we can go for gravity loading also, but more uniform loading will be achieved by means of a hydraulic jack. Okay, so this is mostly preferred. And here also, with load, we have to measure the settlement of the pile. So that settlement of the pile can be measured by means of gauges fixed to it, and that settlement will be measured with respect to a fixed reference mark. So now let's look into the procedure of the pile load test. So here also we will be applying load in increments on the pile, and the corresponding settlements for each load increment will be noted. So about 5 to 8 equal increments are generally used, but the normal criteria is to continue the test until the load reaches double the design load value. Okay, and each load increment will be kept for some time, and in each load increment has to be maintained for some time until the rate of settlement becomes a value less than 0.25 mm per hour. Okay, and then you give the next load increment, that will also be kept for some time until this settlement value is achieved, okay, or it becomes less than 0.25 mm per hour. Then this is continued up to the maximum, double the design load value, and then the final load will be maintained for 24 hours, okay, and then the settlement will be noted. Now this is load applied in increments and corresponding settlement noted. Now the same test can be done by following the constant strain rate method also. There what we do is the load will be increased such that the settlement occurs at a predetermined rate of 0.5 mm per minute. Okay, now this constant strain method is found to be comparatively faster than the other type of method. So once a pilot test is conducted, the result that we obtain is a load and the corresponding settlement value for each load increment. So with that, we'll be able to plot the load settlement curve, and obviously, from the load settlement curve, we are supposed to get the ultimate load or the failure point of the pile. But there will be graphs where you will not be able to get a definite point of failure, like the graphs A and B shown in the upper part, left hand side. So in the A graph, graph A, you can see that the straight line portion is considered for finding the ultimate load QU. Okay, and the second graph B, the straight line portions from both the both upper and lower part of the graphs has been extended, and the point where it meets will give you the ultimate load. Okay, so this is the ultimate load that you're getting. Now, in order to obtain the allowable load, we have to divide this ultimate load by a suitable factor of safety, either 2 or 3. Okay, you can check IS code also which factor of safety to be adopted, what value to be adopted as factor of safety. Okay, but remember that from the graph, what you're getting is the ultimate load for the, of the pile. Now, to have more accuracy, we can even plot a log-log graph for the pile load and pile settlement. So you'll get a graph like this, and where the graph shows a clear point of change, that point will be defined as the ultimate load of the pile. Okay, so this is how the graphs are, the values are interpreted from the load settlement graphs obtained from pile load test. Now, there is a way to calculate the allowable load for a single pile. Okay, so that is as per the IS 2911 part 1 1974. There are three criteria using which we can calculate the allowable load on a single pile. Now, the first criteria says it is 50% of the ultimate load at which the total settlement is equal to 1/10 the diameter of the pile. That means basically you will have to calculate this value first. That is 1/10. 1 by 10 of diameter of pile, that will give you a value. Take that value or mark that value on the settlement axis. And obviously, when you mark that value corresponding to that value of settlement, what will be the ultimate load, you can find out. Okay. So, 50% of that ultimate load will be the allowable load on the pile. That is one way. Now, the second criteria is 2/3 of the load which causes a total settlement of 12 mm. Okay, that is corresponding to 12 mm, you should find what is the ultimate load coming from the graph. Then 2/3 of that load which you have obtained will be the allowable load. Okay, now the first two criteria are applicable when you have data on the load and total settlement values of the pile. Okay, now in some cases you will also be given information on the net settlement values of the pile. That is, once you start releasing the load increment by increment, the pile will rebound to some extent. Okay, that is, this total settlement that the pile has suffered will include the elastic settlement as well as the plastic settlement. Okay, so when you start releasing the load one increment by increment, the elastic part will rebound. Okay, so obviously, the elastic part of the settlement can go back to its original position, and then whatever settlement left in the pile, it is called as plastic settlement. That is a permanent settlement which has happened to the pile. Okay, so that can be known only if the unloading cycle is also given to you. So, in questions where the unloading cycle is also given to you, you will be able to get the net settlement values corresponding to each load increment that has happened during the unloading cycle. Okay, so in such cases, when the where the net settlement values can also be found, that is when the unloading cycle is also given to you, you can find out 2/3 of the load which causes a net settlement of 6 mm. Okay, so basically from the net settlement curve, you have to take 6 mm settlement, and corresponding to 6 mm settlement, obtain the value of the ultimate load. Then 2/3 of that ultimate load will give you the allowable load. Okay, so these are the three criteria which you can apply to the load settlement curve obtained for a static pile load test. And the smallest value out of the three criteria will be taken as the allowable load on the pile. Okay, so that's all about the procedure and test setup of static pile load test. So thank you all.